Thank you, David. Good to see you tonight. Someone asked me a while ago if I was going to the boys' camp out this weekend, and I said, nope, I hadn't camped out since I got out of the Army, and had enough camping days then, but had a great day Sunday, didn't we? And it was a wonderful experience. Matter of fact, our attendance in both Sunday school and worship was the best Sunday that it's been since the pandemic. And so it was a very good day, very productive day. Good to see people saved on Sunday. So we rejoice and we praise the Lord for that. I want you to open your Bibles to the book of Leviticus, find chapter 26. And for those who are our guests, we have been in a study for quite some time now on the doctrine of holiness. And really, over the past month, I guess, I have been looking at some material, or we have been looking at some material in the book of Leviticus as it relates to holiness, because the one single book of the Bible that teaches us more about holiness than any other book is the book of Leviticus. Tonight, I want to close out that portion of the study in Leviticus, and then next week, we will be back to looking at some more generalities pertaining to this particular subject. So, walking through the book of Leviticus requires a lot of attention, because there really are some tough things there to try to understand, but it really does relate, I think, to this subject that we are studying. You know, when I read these two chapters, chapter 26 and chapter 27, there was one word that kind of stuck out to me that we see over and over again. And when we look back over our life, I think oftentimes that word that we see here is a word that causes some interesting reflections, and it's the word if. The word if. You know, that word can't change anything that's happened in the past, but certainly it is a cause for, I think, some interesting scenarios when we begin to think, well, what if? And you know, in my own personal life, I think, well, what if that girl that I dated all through high school, that girl that I'd even talked to about marriage, and what if she would not have run off with somebody else? When I went into the Army. What if that never would have happened? Well, I never would have met Karen, and I wouldn't have had a relationship with her for these last 45 years. First time I saw that lady, it was about 20 years after she'd sent me the Dear John letter when I was in Germany. And first time I saw her about 20 years after that was at a high school reunion. And I remember thanking the Lord, thank you that I received that Dear John letter, because I did a lot better when I landed Miss Karen. But, you know, what if my parents would not have divorced, and I would not have been raised by my grandparents? I never would have received the instruction that I received from my grandfather that I really believe made me into the guy that I am today. What if I had not gone to the Baptist College of Florida, but instead had gone to Jacksonville University like I intended and I had planned and I wanted to do? Well, I never would have met a guy by the name of Wallace Russell, who became my mentor in life and ministry and in so many other areas. I mean, what if Lee would have won at Gettysburg rather than lost? What if Wellington would have lost at Waterloo? I mean, when we think about those ideas, what if a certain thing would have happened? And oftentimes, when we begin to think about those what-if scenarios, sometimes concentrating on the ifs is really an exercise in futility. And yet, sometimes when we think about it, it can be vitally important. And it certainly is an important word in Leviticus 26 and 27. Because the truth of the matter is, the history of Israel that teaches us about holiness, it cannot be understood apart from the ifs that were contained in God's covenant that He gave to the nation of Israel. I think I counted them up correctly. And in Leviticus 26 and 27, the word if is used 32 times. In chapter number 26, there are three if phrases that we find that I think show us the importance of the word and in relation to our understanding of holiness. For example, in Leviticus chapter 26 and verse number 3, if you walk in my statutes and keep my commandments and you perform them. Down in verse number 14, we find that phrase, he says, but if you do not obey me and do not observe all of these commandments. And then down in verse number 40, but if they confess their iniquity and the iniquity of their fathers with their unfaithfulness in which they were unfaithful to me and that they also have walked contrary to me. So these three little if phrases that we find in chapter number 26 I think are important, because the statutes and the instructions that God gave to Israel in these two chapters, now listen carefully, they illustrate four responsibilities that every Christian believer has toward the Lord. And if we do not walk in these four responsibilities, then they are going to hinder our holiness. And so that's kind of where I want to go in this study tonight. And the first thing, the first responsibility that we see that is directly related to one of these if phrases is found in chapter 26, verses 1 through 13. And we're just going to kind of look at the verses as we go through rather than read them all at one time. But the first idea, the first responsibility that we have is in obeying God's commandments. Obeying God's commandments. Down in verse 3, that verse I read a few moments ago, if you walk in my statutes and you keep my commandments. So to walk in the Lord's statutes is the same thing to obey the Lord. And to not walk in His statutes is to walk contrary to the direction that God is walking. So if I'm walking in one direction and God's walking in another direction, what I'm doing is I'm moving away from God rather than getting closer to God. And one thing I am sure of is that if I am walking in one direction, God's walking in another direction, God's not going to change His direction to meet me. See, I am the one that has to change the direction in which I am walking. In the book of Amos, chapter 3 and verse 3, the Bible says, how shall two walk together unless they be agreed? And so if we are walking in different directions, that is, if we are not walking according to His statutes, like verse 3 says, then I'll guarantee you we're going to have some serious problems in life. So when I bring out this idea, our responsibility then is to obey God's commandments, then my question is, well, why should we do that? What is our motivation? What is the reasoning behind that? And these verses point out several reasons. Number one is because of who God is. Because of who God is. Verse 1 of chapter 26, you shall not make idols for yourself. Neither a carved image nor a sacred pillar shall you rear up for yourselves, nor shall you set up an engraved stone in your land or bow down to it. Notice this, for I am the Lord your God. See, God is not some idol that was created by man. God is different. Who is God? He is the God of Israel. He is the God and Father of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. He said, I am the Lord your God. And you'll notice that Lord, L-O-R-D, is in all caps. And anytime you see that title used for God in the Bible where it's L-O-R-D, all caps, that's a special word. It's the name Yahweh. He is Jehovah God, the great I am, the self-existent one that entered into this covenant relationship with Israel and also into a covenant relationship with us through a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. One of my favorite authors of all time, A.W. Tozer, said, and I quote, that the essence of idolatry Is he entertaining of thoughts about God that are unworthy of him? And so when we see the Lord God as the great I Am, Jehovah God, the self-existent one, then we are thinking about him in terms in which we ought to be thinking about him. So we obey God because of who God is, but also because of what God did. Down in verse number 2, you shall keep my Sabbaths and reverence my sanctuary. I am the Lord. Now you'll notice there that the word Sabbaths is in the plural. And so obviously he is not simply talking about the seventh day of the week, the Sabbath of the week, but he's talking here about all of those holidays and festival days that were on the Jewish calendar that were so very important to the Jewish nation. They were referred to as the Sabbaths. And the Sabbaths were those festivals where God's people would get together and they would be reminded of God's goodness toward them. For example, when they got together and they celebrated the Passover, they were celebrating God's goodness in their deliverance from Egypt. When they celebrated the Feast of Tabernacles, they were celebrating God's care for them as they were in the wilderness. When they celebrated first fruits in Pentecost, those were harvest festivals, and they were celebrating God's blessings on their labors in the fields. When they got together and they celebrated the Feast of Tabernacles, that was a feast of joy, and they were celebrating the fruit that God had given them through their vineyards and their orchards. And the entire motivation then for their obedience to this God that Moses just pointed out as being such a great and an awesome God, their motivation was God's goodness. And isn't that our motivation today for obeying God? It's not our fear of his punishment. It is our gratitude for his goodness. In fact, Romans chapter 2 and verse 4 says that it is the goodness of God that leads people to repentance. And so when we see the goodness of the Lord, then that motivates us to walk in obedience. And as we walk in obedience, that impacts our life of holiness. But there's a third thing that he mentions here about why we should obey God, and that is because of where God dwells. Where does God dwell? Verse 2, the B part of that verse, he says, "You shall reverence my sanctuary. I am the Lord." Where did the God of Israel live? Well, we say God is omnipresent. God lives everywhere, everywhere. Well, we know that his presence is everywhere, but in the context of the nation of Israel, where did God live? He dwelt in the camp of Israel. The Jews had this sacred tabernacle in the midst of the camp, and there was this glory cloud that hovered over the tabernacle, and that glory cloud was a symbol of the presence of God. So as they walked up and they saw that glory cloud, that was an indication that this is where God is dwelling. And the nations around them, we know that they had these pagan gods that they had made for themselves, and they dwelt in their temples. But Israel had a God who made his dwelling right there in their midst. So I think the idea of Moses that he was trying to get across here was, how in the world could they ever think about disobeying him when he was so near to them? He dwelt right there in the camp with them. This great God who is the Lord God condescended, you might say, to dwell with them in their camp. And so to deliberately disobey God was not only a violation of his holy law, but in reality, it was a desecration of his holy sanctuary. So if God dwelt there in that place with them, then to disobey him was to violate that place that was sacred, that was made hallowed by the presence of God. So to descend then was to defile the entire camp. And that is why over and over again, the Bible gives us examples of why unclean people were not allowed to come inside the camp, because that sin would defile the camp. And we really don't have to think too deeply or very long to, you know, come up with the application for us today. You know, that tabernacle, that was the sanctuary of God. That's where God dwelt. Where is the sanctuary of God today? Where is it? Where does God dwell? Right, in our bodies. 1 Corinthians 6, verse 15, do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ? Shall I then take the members of Christ and make them members of a harlot? Certainly not. Do you not know that he who is joined to a harlot is one body with her? For the two, he says, shall become one flesh, but he who is joined to the Lord is one spirit with him. So flee sexual immorality, every sin that a man does outside the body, but he who is done outside the body, but he who commits sexual immorality sins against his own body. Do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have from God, and you're not your own? You're bought with a price, and therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. My body is the very sanctuary, the dwelling place of the living God. And that's why Paul says in Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 30, now do not grieve the Holy Spirit who lives within you. I don't know if I'm the only one that senses this, but when I do something and I know that it's not the will of God, and I know that it's something that, you know, is outside of the parameters of what I should do as a child of God, when I do that, there are times when I just sense a heaviness in my spirit. Have you ever experienced that, just a heaviness? You know what that is? I think that's the grieved Holy Spirit who lives on the inside of our bodies. And I, for one, I'm grateful for that. You know, where God alerts me to that, and I sense that grieving and the quenching of the Holy Spirit. But there's a fourth thing that he mentions in verses 3 through 13 of Leviticus 26 about why we should obey God, and that is because of what God has promised. Now, when we think of where were the children of Israel at this point in the history of the nation, and we could say that primarily they were children in their faith. You know, they were like 2 or 3 year olds in their faith. Now, how do we teach children when children are just little children? Do we stand up and lecture them on ethics or whatever the subject might be? No, they're not going to respond to that. The way that we teach children primarily is through rewards and punishment. For good behavior, there are rewards. Then later on, they get a little older and we begin to explain to them more fully the reasoning behind what we are teaching them. But in the beginning, it's rewards and punishments. And I think that's the same way that God taught the children of Israel when they were just children in their faith. He taught them through rewards and punishment. And what he does, he mentions about four things here. He said, now if you obey me, this is going to be your reward. Down in verses 3 through 5, and then again in verse number 10, he said, I'll reward you with rain and with fruitful harvests. If you walk in my statutes and keep my commandments, verse 3, and perform them, then I will give you rain in its season. And by the way, in that part of the world, man, they depended upon the Lord to send the rain. Their life depended upon the average rainfall coming to their fields. He said, I'll give you rain in its season. The land shall yield its produce. The trees of the field shall yield their fruit. Your threshing shall last till the time of vintage, and the vintage shall last till the time of sowing, and you shall eat your bread to the full. Verse 10, you shall eat the old harvest and clear out the old because of the new. I'm promising you, Israel, if you obey me, this is what I will do for you. He promised them peace and safety. Verses 5 through 8, your threshing down in the latter part of verse number 5, you will dwell in your land safely. I will give peace in the land, and you shall lie down, and none will make you afraid. I will rid the land of evil beasts, and the sword will not go through your land. You will chase your enemies, and they shall fall by the sword before you. 5 of you shall chase 100. 100 of you shall put 10,000 to flight. Your enemies shall fall by the sword before you. I'll protect you. I'll give you peace and safety if you obey me. I wonder if things could be different for our land today if we would have done some of these things that God told His people of Israel to do. He said, I'll multiply your population. For I will look, verse 9, for I will look on you favorably and make you fruitful. I will multiply you and confirm my covenant with you. You know, we live in a day and time which it almost seems like, you know, children are a liability, but they look upon children as an asset. And so God said, I will multiply and I will give you children. Then down in verses 11 through 12, He promised them His presence. He said, I'll set my tabernacle among you, and my soul shall not abhor you. I will walk among you, and I will be your God, and you shall be my people. I'll give you my presence. And He said, all of this is dependent upon your obedience to me. And really, we have a New Testament application for that over in 2 Peter chapter 1 and verse number 3. The Bible says, as His divine power, He's given to us all things that pertain to life and godliness through the knowledge of Him who has called us by glory and virtue. And then over in Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 3, He says, I have blessed you with all spiritual blessings in the heavenly places. And yet, just like Israel, God gave them the land. He gave them these promises. But their receiving of these, it was dependent upon their obedience to Him. So God has given us all these things as well. So many blessings, so many promises, and yet it's all dependent upon our obedience. And so the first responsibility then that we see is obeying God's commands. The second responsibility that we have, found in chapter 26, down in verses 14 through 39, is submitting to His chastisements. Submitting to His chastisements. You know, when we think about the nation of Israel, we would have to say that they had this very unique relationship with God. But because they had this unique relationship with God, they were under an obligation to obey God. In the book of Amos, chapter 3 and verse 2, the Bible says, you only have I known or chosen of all the families of the earth. Therefore, I will punish you for all of your iniquities. In other words, privilege brings responsibility. And it's that way in every area of life, isn't it? If we have a great privilege, a great responsibility goes along with that. I consider myself to be one of the most privileged guys in the world. I'm not saying this to try to pat you on the back or butter you up, but honestly, I feel so privileged to be the pastor of this church where I am. There is nowhere in the world that I would rather pastor than right here. And sometimes people say, well, pastor, when you retire, are you going to just do supply preaching all over the place? And I say, no. When I'm done, I'm done. If I wanted to preach every week, I would stay and preach in the best church there is. I honestly feel that way. But I honestly also feel, and this is not false humility, that because of that great privilege, I have a tremendous responsibility. And that responsibility weighs heavy on my heart on a daily basis because I know there's coming a day when I'll have to give an account to God as to how I have shepherded this flock He has entrusted to my care. And you see, Israel had this tremendous privilege, but along with that came great responsibility. And so when they neglected their responsibility, God chastised them. We might use the word punishment. The word chastisement is, I think, the best word there. And that applies to the New Testament believer. Because in Hebrews chapter 12 and verse number 6, the Bible says, those whom the Lord loves, He chastens or disciplines and scourges every son that He receives. You see, biblical love is not tolerance. Biblical love is discipline. Those whom the Lord loves, He disciplines, He chastens. And the whole idea from the rest of these verses in this chapter is that our response to God's discipline will either help us or hinder us in our growth in holiness. When God chastises me and I respond correctly to that chastisement and I repent, then what's going to happen? I'm going to grow in my holiness. But if I rebel against the chastening hand of God, then I'm going to be held back in my growth in holiness. And I don't know if I want to take the time to go through this, but to me, this is absolutely fascinating. In verses 16 through 39 of the 26th chapter, there are six periods of chastisement that are pointed out and described in these verses. And the last one is the most severe, because in the first five periods of chastisement, I'll show you in a moment, but you'll notice that it happens to them while they were in their own land. But the final one, the sixth chastisement, is when God takes them out of the land and He spread them out amongst other nations. And that was the most severe chastisement. There's one phrase that occurs in four different verses that I want to show you. Verse number 18, after all this, if you do not obey me, then I will punish you seven times more for your sins. Verse number 21, then if you walk contrary to me and are not willing to obey me, I will bring on you seven times more plagues. Verse 24, then I also will walk contrary to you, and I will punish you yet seven times for your sins. Verse 28, then I also will walk contrary to you in fury, and I even will chastise you seven times for your sins. Now, that little phrase, seven times or seven times more, is simply referring to a complete punishment. Because in the Hebrew, we know that the number seven is the number that indicates completion. And so what God's talking about is a complete chastisement here. Then He goes through those in verses 16 and 17. I will also do this to you. I will even appoint terror over you, wasting disease and fever, which shall consume the eyes and cause sorrow of the heart, and you shall sow your seed in vain, for your enemies shall eat it. I will set my face against you. You shall be defeated by your enemies. Those who hate you shall reign over you, and they shall flee when no one pursues you. And after this, if you do not obey me, then I will punish you seven times more for your sins. That's a powerful word, the word terror, sudden terror. It's speaking of a confusion of mind. It's the idea that, you know, the way that you feel when you can't explain what's going on and you can't control what is happening. The word consume there, it's the word consumption, and it describes diseases that just slowly would waste away the body. And when we get over in Israel's history in the period of the judges, we find out that God allowed the Gentile nations to invade Israel at harvest time and steal their crops. And all of this was a result of chastisement for their disobedience. And as I'm reading through this, you know, everything within me is wanting to say, well, Israel, why didn't you just obey? But my stars, I ask us the same question today. You know, why don't we just obey? Why do we struggle with doing that? When obedience always results in blessing. Down through verse 18, down through verse number 20. Verse 19, I will break the pride of your power. I will make your heavens to be like iron and earth like bronze. All of this was the result of the chastisement of God. He was trying to break their stubborn pride. Make the heavens like iron. In other words, I'm going to shut the heavens up. No rain's going to come. The earth is going to be made like bronze. You're going to not even be able to till it because it's going to be so hard from a lack of rain. You'll not be able to plant your crops because the seed won't germinate. And God said, I'm doing all of this because of my chastisement of you. I'm trying to break you. Well, Pastor, it looks like they would have yielded, but they didn't. kind of like we read about in the latter days when the Lord comes at the end of the great tribulation. In Revelation chapter 16, verses 9 and 11, the Bible says fire is going to fall from heaven on people. It's going to scorch them. Hail's going to fall and beat their brains out. All kind of bad things are going to be happening. And instead of people falling on their knees and repenting and confessing, they're going to be cursing and blaspheming God. That's what human nature is like, isn't it? That is unredeemed. Down in verse number 26, just moving quickly through this, when I've cut off your supply of bread, 10 women shall break your bread in one oven, and they shall bring back your bread by weight, and you shall eat, and you shall not be satisfied. You think about the things that have happened previously, war, famine, plague. All of those things usually go together. People are crowded up inside of a walled city, hemmed in by the enemy. They run out of food. They become ill. Terrible plagues begin to spread. And all of that is the chastising hand of God. Down in verses 27 through 31, we read some incredibly horrible things. After all of this, if you do not obey me, but walk contrary to me, and also will walk contrary to you, and I will chastise you 7 times for your sins. And listen to this, because there's no food. The crops are not producing. You shall eat the flesh of your own sons, and you shall eat the flesh of your own daughters. And I'm going to destroy the high places, cut down your incense altars, cast your carcasses on the lifeless forms of idols. See, that one of Israel's biggest mistakes was they thought they could worship the living God and a false idol and a false God at the same time. So they would say, well, we're worshiping God, but at the same time we're going to worship this pagan Canaanite deity. And God had to send them into captivity to teach them the lesson. God doesn't share His throne with anybody or anything. No one sits on the platform with God. He's holy God. You don't treat Him like that. But friend, famine causes people to do some horrible things, doesn't it? Like even eating their own children. But then in verses 32 through 39, this section describes the very climax of God's chastisements. And all of that was made necessary because of the hardness of the hearts of His people. Verse 32, I will bring the land to desolation. Your enemies who dwell in it, they shall be astonished at it. I will scatter you among the nations and draw out a sword after you. And by the way, He did scatter the people among the nations, didn't He? When did they come back? 1948, right? That's when Israel became a nation. So God says, I'm going to scatter you. Your land's going to be desolate. Your cities are going to be waste. And then the land shall enjoy its Sabbaths as long as it lies desolate and you are in the enemy's land. Then the land shall rest and enjoy its Sabbaths as long as it lies desolate. It shall rest for the time it did not rest, for the time it did not rest on your Sabbaths when you dwelt in it. Why didn't it rest? Because of their disobedience. And as for those who are left, I will send faintness into their hearts, the lands of their enemies. The sound of the shaken leaf shall cause them to flee. They shall flee as though fleeing from a sword, and they shall fall when no one is even pursuing them. They shall stumble over one another, as it were before a sword, when no one pursues, and you shall have no power to stand before your enemies. You shall perish among the nations. And the land of your enemies shall eat you up. And those of you who are left shall waste away in their iniquity in your enemies' lands. Also in their fathers' iniquities, which are with them, they shall waste away. And all of that was unnecessary. It didn't have to happen. And up until this point, He has chastened His people in the land. But now He chastens them outside of the land by sending them as a captive nation into other nations. Now, just a real quick history lesson. You know that in 722 BC, the Assyrians took captive the northern kingdom, right? The northern kingdom, obviously, was Israel. And then in 605 BC, the Babylonians began to capture the southern kingdom of Judah. And the 70 years of captivity left the land to rest so that the land could enjoy the Sabbath that we just read about. And we know that God mercifully brought a remnant of Jews back to the land, but we also know that the kingdom never regained the power and its former glory like it once had before their life of disobedience. And, you know, you think about Israel, I mean, except for short periods of freedom, such as under the Maccabees, the Jews were always under some control of some foreign power. And the ultimate dispersion, when did that occur? AD 70. That's when the Roman armies invaded and took Jerusalem captive. And friend, the siege of Jerusalem, that was the fulfilled prophecy of Leviticus 26 that we've just read about. And so the whole point of this is that God chastises His people. And if they would have responded to that chastisement, because over and over and over again we read in that chapter, if you will obey me, but you would not, but you would not, but you would not. They could have avoided that. And so the point is that we have to respond correctly then to the chastisement of God. But then there is a third responsibility that we find in verses 40 through 46, and that is trusting His covenant. Verse 40, but if they confess their iniquity and the iniquity of their fathers with their unfaithfulness in which they were unfaithful to me, and that they have also walked contrary to me, and that I have also walked contrary to them and have brought them into the land of their enemies, if their uncircumcised hearts are humbled and they accept their guilt, then I will remember my covenant with Jacob and my covenant with Isaac and my covenant with Abraham, and I will remember, I will remember the land. The land also shall be left empty by them, will enjoy its Sabbaths while it lies desolate without them. They will accept their guilt because they despise my judgments and because their soul abhorred my statutes. Yet for all that, when they are in the land of their enemies, I will not cast them away, nor shall I abhor them to utterly destroy them and break my covenant with them. I'm not going to do that. And oh, by the way, if you don't believe that, read Romans chapter 11. God still has a plan for the nation of Israel. He's going to bring them back. They're going to be restored. For I am the Lord thy God. But for their sake I shall remember the covenant of their ancestors whom I brought out of the land of Egypt in the sight of the nations that I might be their God. I am the Lord. These are the statutes and judgments and laws which the Lord made between Himself and the children of Israel on Mount Sinai by the hand of Moses. But verse 40 is the key thing here. But if they confess their iniquity and the iniquity of their fathers, and what's going to happen? I'm going to forgive. You know, even in the worst case scenario, even in the most hopeless situation, even in the greatest times of sin, there's always hope. Why? Because of the character of God. Exodus chapter 34, verse number 6, and the Lord passed before him, Moses, and proclaimed, the Lord God, who is merciful and gracious and long-suffering and abounding in goodness and truth, keeping mercy for thousands and forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin. That's who God is like. See, God is a God of mercy and forgiveness, but He's a God that will chastise us when we're too hard-headed to listen. Friend, because God's covenant with His people never changes, and God's character and nature never changes, there is always hope for a new beginning. But it only comes through confession and repentance. He will forgive. He will restore. Let me give you two wonderful verses. 1 Kings chapter 8, verses 33 and 34. When your people Israel are defeated before an enemy because they have sinned against you, and when they turn their back to you and confess your name and pray and make supplication to you in this temple, then hear in heaven and forgive the sin of your people Israel and bring them back to the land which you gave to their fathers. If only you will turn to Him and confess and repent. Now, I hate to, you know, beat a dead horse, and I really don't want to do that. But I'm telling you, what we are studying tonight, that is the only hope for our nation. That's the only hope. There is no other hope. We are in a despicable mess. There's no way out but God. And when you think of all the things that have happened, all of the natural disasters, now you think about this pandemic, and you think about the economic trouble that we are in, and you think about the radical driving of us to socialism where there are no personal freedoms anymore. All of those are trying to be stripped away. And God's shouting from heaven, I want to help you. But you got to turn from your sin. It's the only hope for the nation in which we live. And God will do that. See, here's how the enemy works. You mess up. You sin. You disobey. The enemy says, God's finished with you, buddy. Put you out to pasture. Set you on the sideline. Put you on the shelf. Friend, that's the advice of the enemy. That is not true. 1 John 1:9 still works if we confess with our mouths that Jesus is Lord. He'll forgive us of our sins. And while we use 1 John 1:9 never as an excuse to sin, we really ought to use it as an encouragement when we do sin. That if we will confess our sins, He's faithful and just to forgive us our sins. So since God's Word never changes and God's character never changes, there is always the possibility of a new beginning. But you see, obeying God's commands and responding to God's chastisement correctly helps us to grow in our holiness. As a matter of fact, in the book of Hebrews, let me just read these verses to you. You know them by heart. But in Hebrews chapter 12, in speaking with this whole idea of chastisement and what is God up to when He chastises us? Friend, what God is up to is He's bringing us back to Himself. He loves us so much, He's not going to let us just have our own way. So He's seeking to bring us back to Himself so He can get us in a position where He can bless us. In Hebrews chapter 12, therefore we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which does so easily ensnare us. And let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, who is the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before Him, He endured the cross, despising the shame, and is sat down at the right hand of God. My son, do not despise the chastening of the Lord, nor be discouraged when you are rebuked by Him. For whom the Lord loves, He chastens. He scourges every son whom He receives. And if you endure chastening, God deals with you as sons. For what son is there whom a father does not chasten? But if you are without chastening, of which all have become partakers, then you are illegitimate, and you're not sons. Furthermore, we have had human fathers who have corrected us, and we paid them respect. shall we not much more readily be in subjection to the Father of spirits and live? And by the way, being in subjection to the Father and live, I don't think he's talking about living physically, that if we don't live right, God's going to kill us. I think what he's saying is we respond correctly to the chastisement of God, which means that we confess, we repent. What is God going to do? He's going to give us abundant life. For they indeed, for a few days, our fathers chastened us as seemed best to them, but he does it for our profit, for our good, that we might be, here it is, partakers of his holiness. So when we respond correctly to the chastening of God, we grow in our holiness. And so it all goes back to the idea of our living up to these responsibilities. But then there's a fourth thing very quickly. Chapter 27, verses 1 through 34. I'm not going to wade through these verses, but let me just sum them up for you. These verses are about making vows to God. And he mentions many different areas where a person would take and say, now God, I'm committing this to you, making a vow to God, making a promise to God. And the whole idea was promises made to God are to be kept. Have you ever made a promise to God? God, if you will do this, I have. Have you ever broken one of those? I have. And the idea is promises that are made to God are promises are to be kept. Ecclesiastes chapter 5, verse 2, do not be rash with your mouth. Let not your heart utter anything hastily before the Lord. Think about what you're promising and vowing before you make the vow. Proverbs 20, verse 25, it is a snare for a man to devote rashly something as holy. And then afterward, reconsider his vows. God, I promise to do this. God, you get me out of this mess, I'll be a preacher. I'll be a missionary. I'll do anything. Be careful about doing that. And then just let me close out this portion tonight in our study from Leviticus by just highlighting some of the lessons that we have learned. What are the lessons that we learn from the book of Leviticus? First lesson we learn, obviously, that our God is a holy God. Our God is a holy God. And I really, sometimes, I feel like with some of these thoughts that I have and try to communicate it, it's almost like, I think sometimes people look at me like I'm living in another century with some of these things I say. And friend, this is just what Scripture teaches. Our God is a holy God. And I want to tell you, whenever we minimize the holiness of God, we also minimize the sinfulness of humanity. And when we minimize the holiness of God and the sinfulness of humanity, we minimize the cross of Jesus Christ, because that was the only reason for the cross of Jesus Christ, was because of the holiness of God and the sinfulness of humanity. And only the cross could bring those two together. Carl Henry once said, Carl F. H. Henry, it is because God is holy as well as loving that the atonement is provided. The only reason the atonement is provided is because God is holy and God is loving. Everything about God is holy. His wisdom is holy. His mercy is holy. His righteousness is holy. His justice is holy. His counsel is holy. Everything about God is holy. And I really don't want to just be an old, bitter old man. but I'm telling you, the one thing the church has got to recapture today is its belief in the holiness of God. It's got to rediscover this amazing doctrine and get it out of the closet. You know, so much preaching, and I can speak of this because I'm one of those. So much preaching today is so man-centered. Just trying to scratch somebody's itch. Rather than lifting up this thrice holy God who deserves to be worshiped and served and praised. I believe if the church today would just get lost in the concept of the holiness of God, they'd forget about where they're itching. Wouldn't even worry about that. We need a vision of Isaiah when he saw the Lord high and lifted up. The train of his robe filled the temple. He bowed down and said, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God of hosts. The whole earth is filled with his glory." That's the kind of vision of God that we need. Did you know that we as a church can't even do our primary thing if we don't recapture that vision? What is the primary thing we've been called to do? The Great Commission. What is the Great Commission? It's preaching the gospel. There is no gospel apart from the holiness of God, because there is no need of the gospel. So Leviticus teaches us that our God is a holy God. And it also teaches us, secondly, that God wants his people to be holy. 8 times in the Bible, "Be ye holy, for I am holy." And our holiness is directly linked to our witness. You know, in Exodus 19, verse 6, I've used that verse several times, in that covenant that God made with Israel. He said, "You are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood." And as a priesthood, what were they to do? They were to proclaim him to the world. And then we get over to 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9, and Simon Peter uses that verse to apply to New Testament Christians, that we are a chosen generation. We are a royal priesthood. That he says we are to proclaim his praises to the world. So how in the world can we do that if we are not focusing on this concept of holiness? We can't do that. It limits our witness. Because Jesus did not say to us, "You are the lips of the world." He said, "You are the light of the world." The light of the world. And if we don't focus on and concentrate on godly character and conduct and integrity, if we don't focus on those aspects, which are really just a manifestation, an outward manifestation of inward holiness, if we don't do that, we can't be the light of the world. And our witness is hindered. See, not only did Israel suffer because of her sins, but the pagans around Israel suffered because of a lack of holiness in their lives. Israel failed to show the world what the people of a holy God ought to look like. And that's what I'm convicted about. That's what God's called us to. That is what people are to see in me. You know, as I live among my neighbors and in this community, they are to see what somebody looks like that belongs to a holy God. And it's to make a difference in the way I do business. It's to make a difference in my ethics. It's to make a difference in the way that I treat others. That's why holiness is so vitally important. Holiness, thirdly, very quickly, holiness begins at the altar. Holiness starts at the altar. That's what we learn from Leviticus. The book of Leviticus did not begin with a prayer meeting. It didn't begin with a praise service. It began at an altar. And it was an altar where blood was shed, where the innocent died for the guilty. So the book of Leviticus opens up with focusing on five sacrifices, all of those pointing to the Lord Jesus Christ, who was the ultimate sacrifice. And so my personal holiness, where does it start? It starts with my own personal experience with a relationship with God as I recognize I'm a sinner who needs to be saved by the grace of God, and I have an experience with Him at the altar. That's where it begins. And someone who has not had that experience, saving relationship with Christ, we can't teach somebody like that to be holy. Number four, holiness involves obedience and discipline. Obedience and discipline. You know, going back to where we first started, it wasn't enough simply for the Jews to bring an offering and make a sacrifice. They had to obey the rules and the regulations concerning what was clean and unclean for them. And as New Testament Christians today, we don't observe and keep the dietary laws of the Jews, but the principle is there. We are to stay away from that which would defile us. That's why God gave them those dietary laws. These things would defile you. So if I am serious about holiness, I'm going to stay away from that which can defile me. I'm not going to see how close I can get to the edge of the mountain before I fall off. I'm going to stay as far away from it as I can. Abstain, Paul says, to New Testament believers from even the appearance of evil. And so disciplined obedience is a part of holy living. Fifthly, holiness involves priestly mediation. Priestly mediation. That's what we learn from Leviticus. How did those Jews, how did they come to God? Through priestly mediation. And we know who our mediator is, right? The Lord Jesus Christ. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse number 5. For there is one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus. And so the point being made is that we can't walk in holiness apart from fellowshipping with our heavenly mediator. A sixth thing very quickly is that a lack of holiness affects our society. A lack of holiness in the church affects our society. Oftentimes when we think of sin, we think of just individual activity, but that's never the perspective that the Bible paints. You know, we don't try to impose Christian standards on unsaved people. I mean, we wish they would live by them, but we don't try to impose those standards on unsaved people. But there are standards for saved people. And when those standards are compromised to the degree that the church begins to look like the world, then we can have no influence on the world in which we live. Seventh, holiness isn't a private affair. Holiness isn't a private affair. Those Old Testament believers, they were a part of a worshiping community. They lived together in a camp. They depended upon each other. They didn't try to go it alone, and neither can we. Rugged individualism has no place in the church. We can't go it alone. Holiness, number eight, glorifies God. Now, how does my practical holiness, how does that glorify God? It is because I can't make myself holy. There's nothing I can do to make that happen. And so when that holy lifestyle is seen in my life, God is glorified because He's the only one that can do that. I mean, think about it like this. When we read in Galatians 5 about the fruit of the Spirit of love, joy and peace and goodness and long-suffering and temperance, meekness, faith, and all those things. What's the fruit of the Spirit? It is the life of Christ manifest. And so when the life of Christ is manifest in and through my life, Christ is reproduced, you might say, in my living, then God is glorified through that. So God is glorified in our holiness. And then last of all, holiness means living to please God alone. Holiness means living to please God alone. I find this interesting that when an Old Testament Israelite, let's say, defiled himself outside of the camp, and that Old Testament Jew, nobody knew about it but himself, yet he defiled himself. Now, he could have kept that to himself, but if he entered into the camp like that, nobody knew him, the Bible says that it made the camp toxic because God saw it. God saw it. And the principle that's taught throughout the Sermon on the Mount is that everything that we do underneath the eyes of God. And that is why Jesus said, look, when you pray, don't do like the Pharisees and stand up in public and be known for your much speaking. You know, get alone in your closet where only God hears you. And when you fast, don't walk around like the Pharisees with, you know, a grim look on their face and sackcloth and ashes over them, announcing to the world, hey, I'm fasting. No, he said, don't tell anybody but God. And the whole idea that's being taught there is that we ought to live our lives in such a way and practice holiness because the Bible says that pleases God. And our number one purpose in life is to please God. And I know that probably you are like me. I like to be a people pleaser. I do. I like to please people. I want people to like me. Everybody wants that. But at the end of the day, it does not matter who I please if I don't please God. And it does not matter whom I displease if I please God. So I live my life not to be praised by others, not for my own glory, but I live my life knowing, you know what? God sees everything I do. God understands the motivation of my heart. Even when my actions and motivations are questioned and accusation is brought when something I know is just not the truth because I know what's in my heart, God knows. And if I'm living my life to please Him, then I can go to bed at night and I can sleep with a peace in my heart. That's what we learn from the book of Leviticus. Now, next Wednesday night, I want to talk about why is it so important to live lives of practical holiness. And secondly, I want to try to bring out what is it that inspires us to do that? I don't have time for that tonight. We'll do it next week. Would you stand? And we will be dismissed. And Father, thank you for your amazing word. God, the book of Leviticus, especially the stuff we looked at tonight, is almost like it was written today for what we see happening around us today. And God, I know that it is so easy to become weary in well-doing. God, help us not to do so. Help us to fight the good fight of faith. Help us to stand for righteousness and godliness and holiness, speaking the truth in love. And help us to be an influence in the lives of others because of what they see being lived out through us. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. You're dismissed.